I feel a little bit nervous because I'm not very very experienced to perform in foreign language, so please be patient and don't laugh at my stupid mistakes. So, as Ulla said, this talk is basically all about my book Enkelten Verta, or Blood of Angels in English. And I think that this particular book represents in several ways what kind of writer I am, what I want to say, and how. And above all, why I'm fascinated about honeybees. I wrote Blood of Angels approximately for 3 years, and it was published, as Ulla told, in 2011. It has since been translated to English, French and Polish, and the rights are also bought to a couple of other countries. And in my opinion, the English translation is very good. And I think that if you read English, French or Polish, but not Finnish, you can find the book in internet bookshops if you want. I actually started to sketch this novel already in early 2000s, when I first became aware of the phenomenon called CCD, or Colony Collapse Disorder. As you may know, CCD means that honeybee colonies mysteriously abandon their hives, just like that, without a visible reason, and they never come back. To put it simply, the beekeeper comes to see his hives and finds out that nobody's home. No one has this far as I know, come up with a watertight explanation why this happens. There are a lot of suspects, like from air pollutants to vermin, to climate change, pesticides, weakened immunity, bad beekeeping, diseases. There was even an urban legend about how a mobile phone field were causing it, but that was a false alarm. It's possible that the explanation is several factors combined, and recent research implies that the bees disappear from their hives because they simply get lost. Perhaps some chemical makes them to lose their sense of orientation and they are unable to get back to their hives. There is a lot of evidence to suggest that certain pesticides containing substances called neonicotinoids could be one of the causes to that loss of orientation. Well, somebody could ask why anyone should care about a few puny insects getting lost or worries about possible lack of honey in the future. Well, many of you already know that a pretty big percentage of our food production on Earth is dependent on pollinating insects, especially on honeybees. Without pollinating insects, the world would soon face a severe food crisis. So the CCD is not a thing to be taken lightly. But when I read those pieces on news about CCD, like first news 15 years ago, I started to wonder why no one is taking action. It was as late as 2011 when the European Union started to ban some neonicotinoid pesticides. It looks still that no one really cares. Even if it is 40% of our food production at stake. And this was another idea I wanted to write about. I wanted to write about this problem with the bees, but also why we do not want to see unpleasant things. Just like Al Gore named his film about climate change as an inconvenient truth, because he knew that people do not want to hear bad news. And they are in especially big denial when those news might obligate them to change their ways of living. death is one of those inconvenient things the Western civilization seems to be very eager to shun. I mean in real life, because in movies and TV shows, people die like flies, and that's considered entertaining. And we do very well know that those fictional deaths are not real. But when someone really dies, and it's someone we know, for example, someone from our own family, the death instantly becomes taboo. People have serious difficulty to tell their kids that the family dog has died, and they have even more unable to inform them that their granddad has died. Or, as we all know, they would never say died. They would say he passed away, or went to the heaven, or departed this life, because it's taboo. It's something we are not prepared to handle at all, or have to handle with euphemisms. For example, ancient Finns did not say aloud the real name of the bear, because they believed it could come for them, or at least the bear would become very angry when its true name was uttered. So they called it with euphemism, like the king of the forests of the Honeypaw. In an exactly same way, we do not call death death, because if we say it aloud, it may come and get us. And of course, you can see this denial of death in situations like if someone in your family dies, some friends even start to avoid you, like death were somehow contagious. This denial of the existence of death is very present in our culture in many other levels too. Let us think about meat consumption, for example. Every time we eat meat, it very straightforwardly manifests the death of an animal. But we do not let ourselves think about that. The less we know how this chunk of meat has ended on our plates, the better. Now we are killing millions of bees, and perhaps it means that with this action we are also killing our grandchildren, but we do not blink an eye. We are in a deep denial about causing the possible heat death of our own planet, because it's so nice to drive a car. Also, religions and mythologies are full of obsession about denying death. They are brimming with stories of resurrection, afterlife, immortality, and so on. That is another type of denial. We may die, but it's not final. Okay, when I was pondering about this denial thing and in the same time doing research about honeybees, I discovered an astonishing fact. In practically every culture on Earth that knows honeybees, the honeybees are a symbol of immortality and resurrection, or they are considered messengers of gods or travelers between worlds. We Finns can find a good example of that in our national epic Kalevala, in which a mother finds her son dead in the underworld and summons a honeybee from the heavens to bring the son back to life. Suddenly, everything made sense to me in my writing process. What if there was something real behind these myths? I could orchestrate my theme about the denial of death using the story about the disappearance of honeybees. Did they just leave for another realm? I could use the old Greek myth of Orpheus, who traveled to the underworld to bring back a loved one. I could also process the theme of denying death and the idea of immortality in many different macro and micro levels, from discussing animal rights to the idea that how the internet can give people a kind of immortality, because nothing that is in the internet will ever get lost. So this basically was the way how Blood of Angels was born. The story takes place in Finland a couple of years from now, when the CCD has gotten totally out of hand and the food crisis is spreading around the world. My productionist is an undertaker, a specialist of death, who keeps honeybees as a hobby. He has lost a loved one, his son, just days ago, and now he finds an empty beehive in which there is only a dead queen left. This is a shock upon a shock to him, is CCD reaching Finland in this time. He keeps the dead queen in order to send it examined, but then he finds out that when he has the dead queen in his pocket, he can find a mysterious passage into a parallel world, which he starts to call as the other side. It's like the dead queen is a key or a guide for traveling between worlds. And eventually he starts to suspect that perhaps his son is still alive on the other side. How did I end up with such an implausible, even ridiculous idea? Doesn't that sound like a bad fairy tale or something? Am I a total nutcase? Well, the answer is hopefully no. I'm an uncompromisedly rational person. I believe in science. Actually, I get most of my story ideas from scientific facts. I mentioned that I researched the mythologies concerning honeybees, but I also did a lot of research about the biology of bees. I found out that it's no wonder that in mythology, the ideas of immortality and resurrection are associated with honeybees. Without external destructive factors, a honeybee hive actually is an immortal being. Only the individual bees die, like individual cells die in human body, but the whole organism keeps on living. There are theories that those myths of honeybee resurrection are a result of the fact that the honeybees hibernate during winter. The bees are nowhere to be seen during winter, it's freezing cold, and it seems obvious that they are dead. But then the spring comes and there they are again buzzing around. Honeybees are biologically very, very interesting creatures in other aspects too. We all know that they have a very sophisticated communication system, they're dancing, to inform other bees where there are good nectar sites. Their dance movements are complex and they are able to relay with it very abstract information like distance and direction. But when you go really, really deep to the honeybee biology, there are even more amazing facts to be astonished with. For example, they smell in stereo, and their olfactory antennae can sense flowers from kilometers away, and they also locate other bees by smell alone. Their antennae can gauge dimensions. When a bee's antennae touch an object, for example the inside of a honeycomb, they can figure out the depth and width. This helps them to construct consistently sized honeycomb shells. The ability of the antennae to sense touch is also useful for communication. Bees use touch to communicate with one another during bee dances. Honeybees are covered in tiny hairs, each with a nerve at the base. Those hairs are sensitive to vibration. If they detect an unfamiliar vibration frequency, the bee will become alert. Honeybees sense magnetic fields. It's called magnetoreception. And in a way, they thus have a kind of an inbuilt GPS tracker to orient and navigate in their surroundings. And they also are able to sense electricity. People used to think that perceiving natural electric fields was something that animals only did in water. Sharks and eels can do it, for example. But just a couple of years ago, it was discovered that bees could sense electric fields in the air. Like one scientist put it, bees can sense the electric field that surrounds a flower. They can even learn to distinguish between fields produced by different floral shapes. Flowers aren't just visual spectacles and smelly beacons, they are also electric billboards. And the bees, in turn, change the charge of whatever flower they land upon. A research team noticed that the electrical potential in the stem of a petunia goes up by around 25 millivolts when a bee lands upon it. This change starts just before the bee lands, which shows that it has nothing to do with the insect physically disturbing the flower. And it lasts for just under 2 minutes, which is longer than the bee typically spends on its visit. This changing field can tell a bee whether a flower has been recently visited by another bee and might be short of nectar. For the bee, it's like a sign that says, close for business, be right back. All these fascinating biological facts told me one thing. If there were a creature on Earth that would really be able to travel between worlds, I think that the honeybee were indeed the best candidate to do that, to go to the other side. Yes. But what about the other side in my novel? That has to be kind of mumbo jumbo for sure, hasn't it? Well, in quantum mechanics, a radical new theory proposes that parallel universes exist and even may interact with each other. Professor Howard Wiseman, a physicist at Griffith University in Brisbane, Australia, said in a statement 2 years ago, "The idea of parallel universes in quantum mechanics has been around since 1957. In the well-known many worlds interpretation, each universe branches into a bunch of new universes every time a quantum measurement is made. All possibilities, all possible worlds are therefore realized. In some universes, the dinosaur-killing asteroid missed Earth. In others, Australia was colonized by the Portuguese, Hitler won the Second World War, and so on. That means that modern science embraces the concept that the universe we live in is just one of an unknown gigantic number of worlds, some of which are almost identical to ours, but most are very different. And all of those worlds are equally real, existing continuously through time with precisely defined properties. However, the theory doesn't suggest that humans might someday be able to interact with other universes, but Professor Wiseman says that the idea of human interactions with other universes is no longer pure fantasy. So, this kind of other side could really exist. Next question is, why do I mix facts and fiction like that? Fact and fiction like that, the rational and the mystical. Because we do not know everything yet. 200 years ago, electricity was poor magic. Now we all use it daily. As I said earlier, I am an uncompromised rational person. I believe in science, but I also believe that in the things unexplained, there is a treasury of magic and myth and sense of wonder. I don't believe that everything in the world is ever, we are ever able to reduce everything to chemistry and molecular movements, there has to be kind of gray area of mystical and magical. In my novel, one can't enter the other side if there are electric devices nearby. I played with the idea that perhaps sometimes and in some ways, science may even make us a little blind. In the same time as science has helped us to understand our surrounding world and ourselves better and deeper than ever before, there still are dark, mysterious nooks and crannies in this brightly lit building of rationality. In the periphery of knowledge, in those dark cracks and shadows, where the mystery still exists, also my stories emerge. I love to write in the frontier zone between natural sciences and pure wonder, because science shows me new horizons and gives me those things to wonder about. It's the basic nature of science that it perhaps never will find the final answers to all our questions. With almost every discovery, there arises a dozen new puzzles to solve. The history of science is endless wondering and questioning. Literature as an art is for me exactly the same, wondering and questioning. Science is an unbelievably rich source of inspiration for an author. And that's why honeybees happen to become, for me, those little messengers between the sciences and the arts. That's what I try to be, too, in a way, in my writing. A messenger between the sciences and the arts. A messenger between worlds. And the best tool to cross the barrier between those worlds is imagination.